dignity and the way in which it's being engaged in medical care has actually been very contentious. People have looked at dignity in care or dying with dignity as meaning a whole variety of things. Some people would suggest that dignity has been hijacked by the euthanasia-assisted suicide movement, that to die with dignity means to control the exact timing and circumstances of your death. And people on the other side of that political debate would say to take life is anathema to dignity. It's so what's been interesting about the study of dignity is that in some ways people use it as a trump card. They use it to be the ultimate or penultimate argument for whatever contentious position they happen to support. We've tried to take a non-politicized approach to understanding dignity, and that's why we've gone to the bedside of patients and families. I think we've learned a couple of important things. First of all, that there are many, many different things that can influence a patient's sense of dignity, and they're different for different people. That doesn't make the concept futile. It just means that it's a very rich concept that really needs to be probed because it is so textured and layered. The other thing I think that we've learned about dignity is that if the thing that is most predictive of sense of dignity comes back to how people perceive themselves to be seen or experienced by others, for me, that really was a profound epiphany. Again, the epiphany was based on data, but when you start to look at the data and think about its implications, the fact that how we see our patients, what goes on between our ears, was more predictive of dignity than anything else we looked at end of life, whether it was how we managed pain, whether it didn't really matter what parameter we looked at, the single most important predictor came back to what was going on inside of the head of the care provider and how patients perceive that. It has extraordinary implications for healthcare. It means that what matters is not just what we do with patients, not just what we do with patients and families, it's how we actually think about our patients. That's pretty extraordinary. On the one hand, it's very empowering because it's not only the person who makes the first incision who has the ability to have that influence, it's anyone who has patient contact. And we've all experienced this. You know, it can be the receptionist on the phone when you call to the clinic for your first appointment. It can be the person standing in triage that's standing between you and, you know, getting past the desk to see someone. The way you are received has a profound influence on how you perceive care. So on the one hand, I think it's very empowering. It means everyone in a position of having patient contact can make a difference. But the flip side of that is it means we all have to take responsibility for it, right? We all have to realize that there is no neutral position here. I mean, you can say, I really don't buy any of this business about the reflection in my eye and all. I'm just here to do my stuff. I'm just here to, you know, whether it's to give out the medicines or to move the bedpan or to, but the facts are that if you're holding the bedpan in your hand and don't realize that you really can have a profound influence on making that person feel like they amount to no more than a body that needs to be cleansed, as opposed to the fact that they want to be appreciated as a human being.